Hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah. Look at your neighbor and say faith. Hallelujah. Faith, faith, faith. Just a little more faith. Faith, faith, faith. Just a little more faith. You don't need a whole lot. Just use what you've got. Faith, faith, faith. Just a little more faith. Oh, faith, 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 just a little more faith. Faith, 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 just a little more faith. You don't need a whole lot. Just use what you got. Faith, 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 just a little more faith. Hallelujah. You know, that's wonderful. There's nothing like what God has already given you. It's called faith. And he's given you a measure. And if you'll use what you've got, you will find that he will increase it little by little and bring you into that greater and more wonderful place. And he'll do it by stretching you. Amen? And so when I walked on the campground years ago, their theme was faith. Everything was faith. And every building was built by faith. Every seat that was there had come in by paint, by faith. All the 150 different size shapes of carpet down at the tabernacle was given by faith. Hallelujah. All the equipment in the kitchen was given by faith. And people gave it as they were praying. Hallelujah. And Brother Heflin was a great man of faith. He was always determined if God gave him something, he was going to use it. And when he wanted to build the snack bar, he didn't have no money. Look at somebody and say, it's not money you need, it's faith. He didn't have any money, but God had spoke to him that he was going to build another building there. And it was in 1977, one day after the camp was over, Brother Heflin began to take down that old kitchen that was there. And that old kitchen was just a little place in the back where they cooked the meals in the early days when they first begun the camp. Later on, it became the snack bar. And it was known as the snack bar when I came. And the out front of it where the people sat, there were maybe 6 or 8 tables there that had oilcloths on it. It was ground. There was no cement, no nothing. It was just ground with chicken wire around it. And that was the snack bar. Hallelujah. And that was the first year that I was there. That was where I worked, was in that snack bar. And the next year, that day after the camp was over, he began to take that down. And Brother Harold McDougall had come from South America, from the ministry there, and he knew how to use a bulldozer, so he began to dig that hole. And so he dug this great hole after we took down all the chicken wire and all the other stuff that was there, and he dug that basement, or the hole. And then winter set in, and it filled up with water. And so in the spring, after all that water and everything that was there, as it dried out some, it was mud. And Brother Heflin said to us, we need to get that out. So we all, the camp family, which was not many people at that time, we all got down into that hole with buckets, and we bucketed mud. And that mud was up to here. You get in there, you can't move your feet. How many of you know mud has a suction to it? You can't move yourself. And so we had a line of women in that mud, and we were filling buckets and passing it one to another, and two men was up, 12 or 15 feet, pulling it up with lines and emptying it out. And we did that. I was in that hole for 70 days. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Wonderful. And we got that mud out. Hallelujah. And then it was time later on we began to lay that footer. Didn't have the money. If the Lord gave Brother Heflin enough of money for a few bags of cement and a few gravels that came in, he would get out there and he would mix what he had and he would pour that amount. He never waited for the whole thing to come. And with that, he taught us many wonderful things. Your step of faith will begin God's hand moving towards your way. And sometimes we want to know all the details. We want to know everything he's going to do. We want to see everything in full detail. I'll tell you, it never happened at camp that way. It was never in full detail. And so I was there for about 20-some years when Brother Heflin passed away, when Sister Ruth passed away. And I was chosen to begin to take over that ministry, or to be ahead of it, or whatever you call it. Hallelujah. And, you know, I had, down through those years, I went to the nations. I believe God for tickets for the nations. I believe God for my ticket, and maybe I would believe God for your ticket. But I would believe God for my ticket for the nation. God would give me tickets for the nations, and I would travel for 5, 6, 7, 8 months a year, going from place to place, from country to country, and I loved that. I'd come back home and go back into the dish room and wash dishes and be at the camp for the camp season time and go back out. And, you know, I was very conscious that we had a light bill. I was conscious that we had a food bill. I was conscious that we had bills that, you know, you needed for not only for food, but for gas for the vehicles and, you know, all of those things. I was conscious of it. Say conscious. But I wasn't in the knowing. Say knowing. And when Sister Ruth passed away and I became that director and in charge of that, I had not had a light bill of my own for 20-some years. And now I have a light bill that's anywhere from $6,000 to $8,000 a month. And what I tell you, that scared me to no end. And not only did I have that light bill, now it wasn't my light bill, it was camp's light bill, but I was in charge of that thing, and I didn't even ask to be there. I didn't ask for that job, I didn't ask for any kind of promotion, and here I was with that and having a light bill every month that came for $6,000, $5,000, $6,000, and now here now in this time is anywhere from $7,000 to $8,000 to $9,000 a month. And I learned to do this. Just walk with my hands up. Just looking at him, sometimes not even wanting to say anything, because if I'd say anything, it would be negative. Like, what are you trying to do to me? Kill me. And so all of that, all of this financial thing came with that position. And I didn't know what to do with it. I knew it wasn't mine because I don't have no money. But it was a very stressful place for me. And then in that first year, I wanted to do something for the tabernacle to remodel it before we opened the camp. Some rooms, say some rooms. And I said to all the camp family one morning, I want to put new carpet upstairs, and I want to get new beds, and I want to get new covers for those beds and everything for over the tabernacle. And I was just telling them what my vision is. You know, I wasn't saying do it. I was saying just that was my vision of what I wanted to do in this coming year. This was 1 month before camp was to open. And I, after we left prayer that morning, I went to the bank and went done one or two things, gone for about 2 hours. And I came back, and lo and behold, I saw the truck, the dump truck was down at the tabernacle. The windows was up, and it was full of carpet. And they had gone in, the people at camp decided that it was, if I wanted it done, we needed to get with it. So they'd gone up and pulled out all the tabernacle carpet out of every room. It's 1 month to camp time. And I don't have a penny. And I thought, Lord, what in the world is going on? Why did they do that? And I asked them, and I said, What are you doing? They said, you said you wanted to. And I was thinking, one room at the time. You know? Just one room at the time. But I tell you, we put our hearts together, and we prayed, and we believed God, and we worked. Look at somebody and say, and we worked. We worked around the clock. There was not a time that there wasn't something going on in that tabernacle. Hallelujah. And that was just part of it. You still had to do all the other campground, too, to get it ready. But I want to say, by the time camp came, God had supplied. Amen. Hallelujah. We had all the carpet in. One of the brothers, he was just a visitor that had came to me one morning. He says, Sister Jane, I went out yesterday and I found a place where I can buy paint for 50 cents a gallon. And it was paint that other people had bought, and it was not the right color. Hallelujah. And he said, I know how to make it the right color that you want. There'll be enough to do the whole that whole building. Hallelujah. But you have to buy that whole lot. And so we bought the whole lot of that paint. Hallelujah. And he began to take down all the, what do you call it, the wallpaper that was on there. And that was a real job too. And back in the day when they put that carpet down, they used whatever they had. That whatever God supplied, that's what they used. And it had that mesh under the underpad. It was that mesh straw looking stuff. Yeah. And it had nails this long. That was nailed it from, and it was nailed like this with the thing there. And all those nails had to be pulled up and everything. But with God's help, we were able to do that. And in the midst of this, I get this word from our county that we have to do a new water system. And that was going to be somewhere around $125,000. And I thought, oh God, I don't know what we're going to do with those things. And I went to North Carolina, and Debbie called me, and she said, Sister Jane, we found out that we were $188,000 is what it was. And she said, we're going to get a grant for $88,000. And she called me back the next day and she said, oh, I'm so sorry, I made a mistake. I was so excited about this. And she said, called me back and she said, I'm so sorry, I made a mistake. They're going to give us a grant of $125,000. Well, I tell you, that was wonderful. I could have done cartwheels out in the yard. That's where I was. But then I got another message. It's not just $125,000 that it's going to cost you. It's going to be about $325,000. And I tell you, I learned to look unto God and say, Lord, this is not my place. It's your place. This is not my bill. This is your bill. Hallelujah. This is not my people, it's your people. Hallelujah. And so you lift up your hands and you look unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of your faith. Hallelujah. And I want to say that today that water system is in. That building is finished. I've done two more buildings now. God is a wonderful God. He makes a miracle on every hand for you. But I believe this. Sometimes we have to be forced into that place for you to see a miracle, because we reason everything out with our head. Hallelujah. And we think, oh, that's too much for me. I can't do that. But I'm going to tell you, God is able to turn every situation of your life around. Hallelujah. And bring you into new and wonderful places. And down through these, what is it now, 15 years or something like that, I've seen God work miracles every day. Of financial miracles to keep us going and keep us going onward. And we want to invite you to come. We can seat, we can sleep about 200 and some people. And we feed two meals a day. There's no charge for the meals. There's no charge for sleeping. We believe that God will supply enough for you to eat and to sleep. And we expect you to be in the tabernacle worshiping Him and praising Him if you come and stay on the grounds. Hallelujah. And it will be wonderful. Plus all of that and other people going across overseas every year to speak and teach the Word of God. And Jesus says, I give you faith. I put faith in you. He put His faith within us. And His faith never fails. Hallelujah. And the faith that He has placed within you is big enough to get the job done of whatever He's called you for, wherever you are in walking in Him. And faith will multiply. I don't guess I should say multiply, but it will increase, because when you see Him work in this place and He makes a miracle, He'll give you courage to believe for this bigger thing here. And you see Him do that. You will see Him be able to give you another step of that grace and faith to take those steps and walk in faith in Him. Hallelujah. And so as we travel on with Him, now when I say travel, I mean let your faith rise up and put it in Him. Hallelujah. And not in man. Man has called you. And I'm making light of man, because God has put us in a place where we have people that God has always ordained to be a pastor or a teacher or someone that's in leadership. And our first is to be true to God and be under submission to those that are in leadership that we are under. Amen. And it will bring blessings to your life. It will bring great blessings to your life to be submitted unto those that are calling. So I just want to encourage you that in your faith you can do everything. Amen. And that God will honor you. And you never know what He will ask you to do to be a blessing to someone else. And you never know what God will do for someone else to be a blessing for you. Hallelujah. And I had this to recently happen to me back in the, where are we in the year? We're in June, July. We're in July. Back near in the winter camp or one of the season, we were in the tabernacle or in the dining room where we have our meetings in the winter. And as we were there and everybody was worshiping the Lord and all of these things, this lady come running up to me, and she put this bag in my hand, and I looked down at that bag, and it was a Poise sanitary bag. And I was so embarrassed. You know, there were all kinds of people that there was there, and I thought, she just ran up and put this bag in my hand, and here I am holding this bag, and the camera's there, and I thought, Lord, what in the world, and what is this woman doing? Hallelujah. So I surely I got rid of it real quickly. I put it in my in my bag, hallelujah. And I kept thinking, I looked back at her. I never did say anything to her, but I just looked back at her and I thought, how crazy can this be? Hallelujah. And when I got home that night, I pulled that bag out and it had $625 in it. I thought, oh, Lord, that took away all my embarrassment in a moment's time. Hallelujah. You know, God is so good, and He just does things to get your attention. Hallelujah. And also to tell you that He loves you. Well, just recently, another woman came running up and put a bag in my hand. It was a crumpled up, one of those dried pea bags. Where'd you get that salt and pepper stuff in it, you know, like a potato chip bag, but it's another, like a seaweed bag, but it's not seaweed. And it was the worst thing you've ever seen. And in that was $415. Hallelujah. And I said, Lord, do you have another one? Bring it on. Hallelujah. But you know, God is able to do so many wonderful things. He's able to take all your embarrassment away. Hallelujah. And I just ask God to bless these women who have brought those bags to me. And I want to tell you, if you got a bag that looks bad and you want to put something in and give it to me, run, throw it at me, just go ahead and do it. I'll receive it. Hallelujah. It's a wonderful thing. Hallelujah. And so it's been a wonderful journey in the Lord with all of the things that He has done. Hallelujah. And so I'm excited about you. And I'm excited about the meetings that's coming up. The healing and what is it? The freedom. How many of you think you need freedom? And you know, we can say, he that knows the Lord and whom the Son is set free, he's set free indeed. And he has. But sometimes we are bound by a lot of things that were yesterday, with thinking and things that happened 15 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, or 10 years ago. And we've just kind of enclosed ourselves in some things because we say we don't want to be hurt again. And we just kind of close off to things because we don't want to be hurt. And instead of dealing with those things that hurt us, we just kind of close a certain place off. And I'm going to tell you, God will always do something to cause you to open up that place. He will send someone that will punch your button. Someone that will remind you of something that causes that thing to begin to rise up again. And when he does that, it's because he wants you to get rid of it. And there's only one person that can remove it. His name is Jesus. Hallelujah. And when we bring it to him, he's able to set us free and to make us every whit whole. Hallelujah. And I think that probably everybody in the body of Christ needs the deliverance of some kind. If it's nothing but deliverance from yourself. Really. For self is your worst problem. Hallelujah. And so God is so good and he's so wonderful and he does great things in our lives. Amen. How many of you have been to Israel? How many of you want to go to Israel? How many is going to sign up and say, here I am, Lord, I'm ready. Hallelujah. Because I'm telling you, I've seen so many miracles with people going to Israel. People that didn't have 5 cents. They come up and sign up, get a brochure, go up front, put it on the floor and dance on it. Take it home, put it in their bed and sleep with it. Some of them put it in their shoe and walk on it. Hallelujah. Just believe in God that he will make a miracle for them. Hallelujah. And you know, God does. He makes miracles for many, many people to go to Israel. And I believe that God would have everyone to go to Israel. And he's the greatest guide. You know, we have a guide when we go that can tell you some of the history and the historical places. But Jesus lived there. And he wants you to come to his hometown. And he wants to take you down the old city and show you all those old places where he used to walk, the places where the place where he died, the place where he was resurrected. He wants to tell you all the wonderful things about those places. Hallelujah. And it's so wonderful that as you go to Israel, you can be on a busload with 60 people, and you might feel that nothing is happening for you in certain places. And then suddenly, you're in a place where everything becomes light and bright. And he begins to deal with you and show you wonderful things pertaining to him and that country. Hallelujah. And I believe that it would just be a great delight for the Lord for you to be able to go. And therefore, I believe that he always will make a way for you to go as you put it into his hand and you truly pray and believe. Pray and believe it. And I believe that he'll make a way. Hallelujah. Wonderful Jesus will do wonderful things to make a way for you if you will listen to him. He could he could just have you to find some money on the ground. Yeah. And he could do just about any way of doing to bring you into that place of going. Amen. He could speak to someone else to help you, or he could speak to you to help somebody else. All of it's wonderful. But Jesus is wonderful in all of his wonderful, wonderful, wonderful ways. Hallelujah. In John chapter 2, it's probably everybody knows this wonderful scripture. Hallelujah. It says, on the third day there was a wedding at Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And Jesus also was invited with his disciples to the wedding. And when the wine was all gone, the mother of Jesus said to him, they have no more wine. And Jesus said to her, woman, what is that to you? And what is it to me? What do we have in common? Leave it to me. My time, my hour to act has not yet come. And his mother saith to the servants, whatsoever he saith to you to do, do it. And there was 6 water pots of stone standing there, as the Jewish customs of the purification ceremonial washing demanded holding 20 to 30 gallons apiece. Say 20 to 30 gallons apiece. And Jesus said to them, fill the water pots with water. And they filled them to the brim. And then he said to them, draw some out now and take it to the manager of the feast, to the one presiding, the superintendent of the banquet. So they took him some. And when the manager tasted the water, just now turned into wine, not knowing where it came from, thought the servants who had drawn the water knew, he called the bridegroom. And he said to the bridegroom, everyone else serves his best wine first. And when people have drunk freely, then he serves that which is not so good. But you have kept back the good wine until now. And this is the first of the signs of miracles and wonder works that Jesus performed in the Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory. By it he displays his greatness and his power openly, and his disciples believed in him and they trusted him and relied on him. Hallelujah. And so I'm going to stop right there for a moment and let's go back up to the top of it and just look at that. It says it was on the third day there was a marriage in Cana and the mother of Jesus was there. Hallelujah. Now the mother of Jesus had been spoken to when Jesus was born, and there were some things in her heart that she had been pondering all along. Hallelujah. And she had watched her son grow up, and she had a knowing that he was the Son of God. She knew that from the heavenlies, God spoke to her and said, his name shall be called Jesus. Hallelujah. And she knew many wonderful things that the Lord had spoken to her concerning her son. And now she has watched him grow up, watched him fall down, watched him eat, watched him work, watched him over him. Hallelujah. And all the time knowing that there was a place and things that Jesus was going to come into. And so she opens her mouth and she says to Jesus, talking to her son, and after it was, and it tells us that both Jesus and the disciples were there, those that he had handpicked. Look at your neighbor and say, he's handpicked you. Hallelujah. He's got some wonderful things for you. He's got some wonderful things for you. He's got wonderful things for you. And he believes that he made a good pick when he picked you. Hallelujah. He believed that you can do everything he's called you to do. He believes that he is the one that empowers you, enables you, and gives you the ability to work the works that he did and greater works than this. He believes that he has made you holy. He believes that you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He believes that you are his temple and that he wants to fill his temple with glory and with his power, with his presence, with his joy, with his strength. And he wants to send you forth to represent him, not in some small way, but in the very brilliancy and beautifulness of who Jesus is, doing and working and being exactly like him. Now look at your neighbor and say, honey, you got a long way to go. Now stretch your hands toward me and say, Jane, you have a long way to go. I know it. Hallelujah. I am asking him every day to change me to be more like him. Hallelujah. And the more I ask him, the more I can see I'm not in some certain areas. But you know, there's still hope because he's still working on me. Now look at your neighbor and say, don't give up. Keep on hoping, for there's something good coming your way. Hallelujah. He's working a little bit more every day to bring us into that place of looking like him or acting like him. Hallelujah. And so she was there and the disciples were there. And how many of you know that everywhere Jesus went, he was training his disciples for yet that day when he would not be there. Amen. And every miracle, every sign, every wonder was also to magnify and glorify the name of Jesus, but also to encourage and strengthen the believers that they might believe in him, the ones that he had chosen, that he is Jesus, that he is the Son of God, that he is the Messiah, that he is the one that's coming. And he had chosen them for the great preaching and teaching of his word in that day when he would be taken up and seated at the right hand. But while he was on earth, he sent them out and they worked miracles and signs and wonders. And they came back and reported to Jesus what happened. Amen? And so he's sending us out, and we should always come back and report to Jesus what he's done. Say, oh, look what you have done. It was so wonderful. Hallelujah. And it's so wonderful. Amen. And so it said that when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus said to them, to Jesus, he said, son, they have no wine. And Jesus speaks to her. And he says, woman, what have I to do with you? My hour is not yet come. Hallelujah. It's not my hour to act yet. It hasn't come yet. Jesus knew that there was an hour that was there that was coming. And he said, that hour is not here yet. And sometimes you and I on this side of the cross, we say, I know that Jesus has called me. I know that he's already told me that I'm going, but it's not my time yet. And if we wait for us to determine when our time is, we will never go. Because it's not for us to choose, it's for him to choose. Amen. And you say, well, I know that Jesus told me that there was healing in my hand, but I don't feel like there's healing in my hand. I haven't brought any healing to anybody yet. Well, my question is, have you laid your hands on anybody? Have you prayed for anybody yet? Have you found that place where you can say, I know that the Christ I serve, he is a healer, and he wants to heal you. Let me pray for you. And so until we begin to do that which he's called us to do, you will never see the miracle that he has planned behind it. Amen. And Brother Heflin used to tell us, he said, God spoke to me that I had healing in my hands. And he said, the first three people I prayed for died. And his mother said to him, son, Jesus never makes a mistake of what he tells you. And so you just keep on laying your hands on the people. Yeah. And the end results, he had a great healing ministry. And Brother Heflin was known all over the world for healing that God gave him. I've seen him take babies out of the arms of mothers. That baby never walked or never talked. Take him in his arm, take him away and put him on the floor. And when he would let go of that child would run to his mother, never walked in his life. I've seen him call people that's in a wheelchair and he just jump off the stage and go down and say, what's wrong with you? And they tell him, he said, get up. And they get up and God healed him. Just marvelous, wonderful thing. He had a great healing. But the first three people he prayed for died. Hallelujah. But you can't allow that to deter you. You got to keep on keeping on. Looking unto Jesus, the one that called you unto that great and powerful place in him. Hallelujah. And so he said to his mother, he said, it's not my time yet. And his mother, how many of you know his mother was a very wise woman? It wasn't that she ignored what he said so much, but she had a knowing that was beyond a knowing that God was going to bring her son into a place. And so she said to the servants, whatsoever he says to you to do, you do it. She didn't know what he was going to say. But she said, when he says something to you, you just do it. And that's one of the most wonderful places where you are today, that whatsoever Jesus, the Son of the living God, say to you to do, do it. Amen. It may be something simple. It might be something complicated. It might be something that you can do in the spirit or just in prayer. Or it could be something that you could do just by touching somebody and releasing your faith for them and God bringing a miracle for them in your life. Hallelujah. And so as we will do what he tells us to do, hallelujah, and just walk in that place of doing it, we will see miracles and signs and wonders begin to happen in our own lives in a greater and more wonderful way. It's just because we are obedient to what he tells us to do. Hallelujah. And so one of the first things that God spoke to me to do after I went to camp, there was a young man by the name of Richie Polyfox. Richie Polyfox had come out of drugs. He was a drug ring, one of those drug addicts from California. And he was in one of those, what do you call it, rings? Is that what you call it? Drug rings and all of that. And God had brought him out and delivered him from that. And he had gone through Youth for Mission, Youth for Life, A New Life for Youth. And he came to camp, and he worked under me for that first year and second year. And one year, God said to me, you know, there used to be a lot of rolling going on at camp. People would just start rolling, and it would be a wonderful thing when the Spirit of the Lord would touch them. And I have rolled many, many times. Hallelujah. It's wonderful. Hallelujah. And so one year I decided in the Lord that every person that worked with me would roll. And I was going to believe God for them to roll. And because it's wonderful. You know, when God does something in your life, it's absolutely wonderful. Absolutely gloriously. And so every day, every night at 1:30 in the morning, I went to the prayer room and I prayed for 1 hour, believing God that these people would roll. Just lifting my hands and praying in the Holy Ghost that all these people that's on my team would be rolling. Hallelujah. Before the camp season was over. Hallelujah. And so I went down faithful every night, lift up my hands and walk with my hands up, just saying, thank you, Lord, they're going to roll. Thank you, Lord, for putting that rolling spirit upon them. Oh, yes. Thank you, Jesus, for doing it. And one by one, they rolled. But there was this one by the name of Richie. His mother sent him. Now, Richie was wonderful. He could sing. He could dance. Oh, my goodness. He would lay on the floor on his face. Hallelujah. And he would cry out to God. And his mother sent him a beautiful pinstripe suit. And when he had that suit on, it changed his characteristics. He no longer got on his knees. He always stood. He's always straightening out that jacket. Hallelujah. And there was a young man that we called him Hoss. He was invited to go to he was invited to be in a wedding, and he didn't have a suit. And he asked Richie if he could borrow his suit. And Richie said, no, you can't borrow my suit. So that suit became a hindrance to him, a hindrance to his worship. He was no longer free. He didn't want to dance like he used to dance because he didn't want to sweat in it. Hallelujah. And so when he had on that suit, he wasn't the same. And just before the end of the camp, he also worked with me in the snack bar. Somebody came and said, you need to come down to the camp, down to the tabernacle and look at Richie. He said, he's rolling all over that place down there. So I left the snack bar. I ran down there and I stood at the back and I watched him rolling, and he had on that pinstripe suit. Hallelujah. And by the time he finished rolling across that floor, that suit was halfway across his head. One arm was out of it. Hallelujah. And it was a marvelous, wonderful thing. And when he came to the snack bar, which was very, very late, it was almost over, and we have this door that's there, he leaned up against that door and he slid down it and lay on the floor there for a long, long time. And God changed his life that night. But while he was rolling, God spoke to him that he would be going to Israel. And that God would be with him and wonderful things would happen. And so I didn't know that at that time. But when he got up, I asked him, I said, well, what did God say to you? And he told me about God speaking to him to go to Israel and to that he would be there for a while. And I went home that night, and I got ready for bed and lay down, and I was praying and thanking God for everything. And God spoke to me and said, I want you to pay his way. I said, what do you mean pay his way? He said, I want you to pay his way. I said, I don't have no money. You know how many of you know that God doesn't know, he knows where you got money or not. But we always want to tell him what we don't have. I said, I don't have any money. He said, I know that. He said, but I want you to pay his way. And oh my goodness, I thought, Lord, how am I going to do that? I don't have any money. I'm not going out anywhere. We're in camp time. And I don't have any doors open to go speak nowhere. How am I going to do that? And I kept on thinking, praying, thinking, how is he going to do that for me? And I was invited to come to North Carolina to speak. And while I was there, the Lord gave me enough of finances to pay his way to do that, and enough of finances to do something else that he had told me to do for somebody. And I came away from there, I was rejoicing in the Lord. And to make a long story short, Richie went to Israel. He was there for almost 3 years. God gave him supernaturally the language, the Hebrew language. He speaks it fluently, absolutely fluently. Hallelujah. And the Lord also, after he came back home, he joined the Air Force. I think it's the Air Force. And during those time, he was also sent to Israel to be one of those to protect her during those times. Hallelujah. And so God did some wonderful things in his life. Hallelujah. And it happened while he was rolling. Hallelujah. Yeah. And when he got up from there, he gave that suit away too. Hallelujah. So it's wonderful. So Mary, the mother of Jesus, he said to tell whatever he saith to you to do, do it. Hallelujah. And there were, it tells us that there were 6 water pots that were there. And it tells us that those water pots held anywhere from 20 to 30 gallons apiece. And they told them to fill those water pots with water, and they filled them up to the brim. Hallelujah. And if you do that math, if it's 30 gallons a barrel, 6 threes are 18, that's 180 gallons of wine. Wow. Say, that's a lot. Wow. And if it's 20 gallons, then it would be 160 gallons. So anyway, whether it's 20 or 30 gallons, that's a lot of wine. Yeah. So that tells me there was a lot of people that was there. Hallelujah. And God never does anything that he's not making a statement about something to bring us into that greater place and show us that wonderfulness of who he is. And so when he told them to fill it, they have a choice to do or not to do. Hallelujah. They could have said, no, I'm not going to fill those water pots. I don't want to fill them. I've already been working all this time today. And Jesus just said, would you do it for me? Would you do it for me? And so they go out and they fill it. Wonderful. And it was wonderful. They fill the water pot. That was all that he asked them to do. And he didn't tell them what he was going to do. He didn't tell them how he was going to act. He didn't tell them what the results was going to be if they fill it. He didn't sit down and give them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different things that's going to happen with the fullness of that water pot. Amen. He just said, fill it. And whatever was to be done from that point on, that was in him. And that's all he asked you and I to do, is that we be filled with the water of his spirit. Hallelujah. To be filled like one of those water pots, that we would be filled to the brim. Hallelujah. That river of the living waters that is within you to overflow, or that well of salvation, the wells of living water that is within you to rise up and come into the fullness thereof. Hallelujah. You're nothing but a water pot. Hallelujah. Or a riverbed, however you want to call it. Be a riverbed, be a water pot. Hallelujah. But be filled with God. Be filled with His purpose. Be filled with His love. Be filled with His joy. Be filled with His strength. Be filled with what He has called you to be. Amen. And so they were obedient to go and fill the water pot. It didn't take any faith to fill that water pot. Why? Because they had water. And they had the box. But it did take some to do some work. Look at somebody and say, do the work. Yeah. Yeah, just do the work. That water didn't jump in there all by itself. Hallelujah. And so they had to do it. They'll fill the water pots, and you and I need to do something. Look at your neighbor and say, do something. Get into actions. Hallelujah. If you need to plant a garden, you got to put a seed in the ground. Hallelujah. If you want a financial breakthrough, you need to do something to get that financial breakthrough in your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you want to go overseas, do something. Hallelujah. Stand in His presence and pray. Lift up your hands and say, I believe you, Lord. Hallelujah. Go out and do something for somebody else if you want somebody to do something for you. Hallelujah. Go out and mow their yard. Hallelujah. Feed their dog. Walk their dog. Hallelujah. Whatever it needs to be done, do something. Hallelujah. I was brought up on a farm and we milk 33 cows twice a day. And I want to tell you, I never saw one of those cows just spread her legs open and milk come pouring forth without doing something. If you want that milk, you want that butter, you want the buttermilk that comes from it, you're going to take hold of those things and start pulling. Yes. I can see you know how. Hallelujah. Wonderful Jesus. But you got to do something. And sometimes we don't want to do nothing. We just say, Lord, just pour it down from heaven. And He doesn't do it like that so much. Sometimes. And so they filled them to the brim as Jesus told them. And then Jesus says to them, you go now. Draw some of it out and go to the manager. Go to the head table. Go to the important person, the superintendent of the banquet. That's in the Amplified. And say, they took him some. What were they taking him? Water. That's what they filled it up with. They filled it up with water. And Jesus now says, take it out to the president. This is the president right here. Wave your hand. This is the president. Said, take it out to that table first. And you know, they may have hesitated in that because that's an important man. And they know that that's water in there, and what they're asking for is wine. And Jesus didn't tell them what was going to happen when they got there. He didn't say, now don't you worry about this, because when you get there and pour it out, it's going to be wine. He didn't tell them that. And He doesn't tell you that when you get to a certain place and you lift up your voice and you speak His word, He doesn't tell you what the results of that word is going to be, but He does say, I'll go with you with signs and wonders that will follow you as you have faith in my name. And I'll put words in your mouth. I'll give you revelation. I'll give you understanding. Hallelujah. And when you leave, you will leave people with faith, because I am faith on the inside of you. Hallelujah. And I will bring you to that new and wonderful and glorious place. And even though Jesus said, it was not my time yet to become acting in signs and wonders and miracles, yet that was the beginning. And from then until the Calvary, He did signs, wonders, miracles everywhere he went, turning people's lives upside down and changing the way people think and giving them new ways of living. Hallelujah. And Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you, he is the greatest preacher that there is. Christ in you, he's the prophet. He's the teacher. He's the apostle. Hallelujah. He's everything. He's everything to you and he's everything to me. And though you have not begun yet to walk in that place where he's called you as a minister, this is your day. This is your hour. This is when you shall arise and go forth in the name of the Lord who has called you. And the Bible says that as they gave this wine to them, hallelujah, and when the ruler, this brother over here, he's the ruler, hallelujah, had tasted the water that was made wine, and he knew it not, he said to the servants which drew the water, called the bridegroom to come to him, because he wanted to find out something. In other words, he said, Jesus, you're a strange man. No, he didn't say that to Jesus. He called the bridegroom to him. And he said to the bridegroom, you're strange. Never met anybody like you. I've been going to a lot of weddings. I never met a man that put out the worst wine first and saved their best to the last. You're different. And I wonder if he said to that man, you don't understand. I did put out my best wine. Not only did I put out my best wine, I put out all of my wine. And I was short. I was short on it. And I was embarrassed. And this man called Jesus, he said, oh, he's standing at that pole over there. That man called Jesus. His mother was here also, and his disciples. And he said, his mama told him that you didn't have any wine. And he told those servants to fill that pot with water. And what they brought you, sir, was water. But what you drank was wine. And there was a miracle that took place in the water by the time they started pouring it out. Or maybe it didn't. Maybe it only became wine when he poured it. And they keep on pouring it. For the miracle was in the word called do it. That's where the miracle is, in the word called do it. And they carried it. And they poured it accordingly. And the bridegroom was delighted. And the governor was too. But the Bible says this. And every man, oh, that's where he said it. This is the beginning of miracles of Jesus in Cana of Galilee. Manifest his glory. And his disciples believed on him. So something happened in that miracle wine that caused faith to arise in those that he had chosen. And they believed in Jesus. They were already his disciples. But they came to know him that day in a new and wonderful way and a new commitment to follow him within. And God wants to, for you and me to come into that place of that new commitment in him. Hallelujah. And see that glorious presence of God pouring in to your life and into my life, for he is wonderful. And when I first started traveling the nations, not knowing much, I'm going to tell you, you don't have to know much to do a miracle. You have to know a person named Jesus. That's where your much comes in. Know him, for the miracle comes from him. I went to a hospital. I was invited to go to a hospital and pray for this little boy. And the little boy had cancer. And in his buttocks, there was a hole about like this of where the meat had been eaten away in his butt. I didn't know that in the beginning. And I'd pray for him, and he had some activity. And the mom said he hadn't been able to move like that for a long time. And he had thrown his bottle out of the crib, and they were so excited that he threw that bottle out. And that was strange to me, because most people don't want their babies throwing the bottle out of the cribs. But he hadn't been able to move like that or to do things like that. So they were excited because he had that movement. And so they showed me his buttock, and I said, well, let me pray for him again. I took him in my arms and I prayed for him, gave him back to his mom. And I was gone for another 3-4 months before I went home. And when I got home, there was a letter there and a picture with it. And God had sealed up that hole. Yes. Hallelujah. And he was completely made whole. Yes. Hallelujah. No, I say, God, he did wonderful things. Hallelujah. And I didn't know that what God was going to do, but I do know that he said, if you call upon his name and ask anything in the name of Jesus, believing it in your heart, hallelujah, and confessing it with your mouth, he will give you whatsoever you are asking for. Hallelujah. I know that the Bible says this, that I am the vine and you are the branch, and the life of Christ flows through you. And if the life of Christ that flows through you flows through your hands and touch somebody else, it's going to bring a miracle or something or a hope in somebody's life. Hallelujah. Wonderful Jesus. And that night we left from that place and we started walking at 2:00 in the morning to get to another place to catch the bus in the morning at 5:00. We'd had a meeting that night and it finished about 12:00. And then we started walking about 2:00. Hallelujah. This is the joys of missionary. Hallelujah. So we got there about 4:00 in the morning and to a home, and that's where the bus would stop. And we were sitting in there waiting, and the mistress came in and said, I've got breakfast almost prepared for you. I'll be back in a moment. And she said to me, she said, would you pray for that young girl over there? And I said, yes, I'll pray for her. She said, she's been waiting for you to come all night long. And I said, well, what's wrong with her? She said, she doesn't speak. She doesn't hear, and she doesn't speak. And this is like 4:00 in the morning. We've been walking. She came over, and we prayed for her. And God opened her ears and gave her the ability to speak. It was an amazing moment. It was an amazing moment in my life. I was probably changed more than that girl was. To know that Jesus honored her faith. She had waited all night long. Hallelujah. For us to come. To lay hands on her. And God honored her by giving her hearing and abilities to speak. But he awakened my heart to something far greater. This was a long time ago, and when I first started traveling for Jesus. Hallelujah. And so as we travel, we would stop up in the Philippines. We would stop at a little sorry store. And whoever was in there, I would pray for them before we left. And in one of those sorry stores, the woman was getting our stuff, and I said to her, "The Lord shows me that you've got pain in your back." And she started crying. She said, "Yes, ma'am, I've had excruciating pain for a long time." And I said, "I'm going to pray for you. I believe Jesus will heal you." And I did. I prayed for her in her store. She fell. When she got up, she had no pain. And once she got up, I paid for the things that we got. She went out, closed the door, and went out. And we were sitting out in the yard just drinking our hot Coca-Cola. No ice up there. Have you been to the Philippines? Need to go. Up in the mountain, there was no ice, there were no refrigerators, no nothing. But they had Coca-Colas and they were hot. I learned to drink hot Coca-Colas. Hallelujah. Within 15 minutes, she had 70 people gathered together under a tree out there. All of them needed Jesus and needed healing. Hallelujah. And we had a wonderful, wonderful time. And that everywhere we went with a little ukulele. Mercy was playing the ukulele, and we would sing a song as we would go along. We'd go in a place to eat, and she'd play that thing, and we would sing our prayers out. Hallelujah. We'd go into the gold mines and pray for the people there. We just went everywhere praying for people and seeing God do signs, wonders, and miracles. And on our way from one place to the other, we would stop in these places and just stop and pray for people. And God would do something. And Mercy, she was wonderful on that ukulele. And she would sing a song. "In the valley, he restoreth your soul." Yeah. And we would go into businesses. And I would ask the manager, "Can we sing a song?" And they would say, "Yes, you can sing a song." And she would begin to sing, "In the valley, he restoreth your soul." And people would begin to weep. People would get up and come. Some of them would say, "I used to know Jesus. I used to go to the church, but I'm not going anymore." Renew their hearts to them. Hallelujah. Get healed, get delivered, get set free. We had a great time. And we knew nothing. We don't know what God's going to do until you step out and just begin to do what he asked you to do. Hallelujah. And when he asks you to do it, he's going to be with you to back you up. Amen. To honor you, to honor your faith in the Lord, and to go with you with signs, wonders, and miracles. Yes. That declares Christ is with you. He is faithful. Amen. He is kind and he is merciful. The Lord saith unto thee, "I have called you, saith the Lord. I have anointed you and I have sent you, and surely thou hast done a great work. A great work in me, saith the Lord, and a great work amongst the peoples that I have sent you to. And the Lord saith unto thee, it's a new day, it's a new hour, it is a new moment. And I say unto thee, I am the open door, saith the Lord. And I shall open a new door for you. I shall open it, saith the Lord, and I shall carry you through it. And you shall walk in a place where you have never walked. You shall be in a place amongst people where you have never been. And the Lord saith unto thee, thou shalt also experience a move of my spirit as thou hast never experienced it before, saith the Lord. For in these days, saith the Lord, they are the last days, saith the Lord. They are the days that are filled with much problems and much troubles and much heartaches. And the Lord says, I send you forth to be as a balm that is poured out upon them, saith the Lord. I send you forth to speak a word that will bring hope unto them. And I send you forth to bring healing and deliverance, and not only in their minds, saith the Lord, but in their bodies, saith the Lord. And I say unto thee the blueprint that I have given unto thee, that which I have spoken unto thee years ago, things that you have seen me to bring to pass and things that you haven't seen. The Lord saith unto thee, get your blueprint out and look at it again, saith the Lord, for there are some things that are about to come to pass, saith the Lord, that I spoke to you years ago, and you shall see it come to pass. Now the Lord saith unto thee, my daughter, I have called you, I've blessed you, I have filled you with hope and delight and joy, and I have made thee to be a voice that has been lifted up, and I say thou shalt lift it up anew. Yea, thou shalt blow the trumpet, saith the Lord, and you shall see the gatherings of the people that shall come, and you shall speak, you shall teach, you shall declare my glory in a new dimension that thou hast not known. Now the Lord saith unto thee, have I not spoken to thee? Have I not told thee? Have I not showed thee that I, the Lord who is everlasting, that my word would never return void, that I would speak and it would come to pass, and will I not use your mouth that you might speak and that it shall come to pass, saith the Lord? Now the Lord says, lift up thy hands, my daughter, for this is a new day. It's a new hour. It's a new moment. Hallelujah. And he says unto thee, I love you with an everlasting love. I shall never leave you. I shall never forsake you. I shall always cause you to know the heartbeat of thy God. And surely the Lord saith unto thee, even as Esther stood before the king, I have given you favor, saith the Lord. And you shall find favor amongst the peoples where you go, and favor everywhere you go, for I am with thee. And I see the Lord, the light of the Lord, upon you. I see it running, as it were, across your shoulder like a laser beam of a light, across your shoulders, going down into the center of your back and coming around, making, as it were, a beautiful buckle on the front side. And I can tell you that even the stressful things and the places that's been painful in your body is going to leave. For the Lord saith unto thee, this night I do a miracle for you, saith the Lord, and I bring you forth into that new place, for you are mine by choice. I chose you. I love you. I don't compare you with anyone else. You are mine, saith the Lord, and I am yours. Arise and come with me, for it is a new day, saith the Lord thy God. Hallelujah. And so as we become those that do the word of God, then you will find that that miracle will flow. Hallelujah. What's your name?
Stephen.
Stephen. That's good. Can you stand? You know, Stephen, God has a great thing for you. Are you running with him?
Yes.
How far?
I went 2 years by Miss Cleveland, and I pray a lot.
That's wonderful. Have you been overseas yet?
No.
Why not?
I have a criminal record.
You do?
Yeah.
Well, I think Jesus wiped that out. What do you think?
Well, I believe it.
Yeah. That's where favor comes in. You want to go overseas?
Well, for sure.
Get your passport. And we believe God for a miracle. Hallelujah. God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for Stephen. We thank you, Lord, that you've called him. You have changed his life. You've made him to become a brand new creation in you. Old things were wiped away. Hallelujah. All things new has become new in his life. Hallelujah. And Lord, we believe that you wipe his slate clean in the natural as well. That you take these things that is against him, oh God, and make it clean. Give him favor. Lord, we thank you for his passport. We thank you, Lord, for his being able to go and to proclaim your name in power and in demonstration in Jesus' wonderful and glorious name. Hallelujah. And God will do something. God, he will do something great and wonderful in you as you lead him and guide him. Hallelujah. And I want to remind you that Moses had a criminal record. He killed a man. Paul had a criminal record. Yeah. Hallelujah. Wonderful Jesus. And many others had a criminal record also. But Jesus changed it. Hallelujah. I want you to run for your change all the way around here. Believe God for that change. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and say, he's able to wipe it clean. Hallelujah. Oh, he's able to give him favor. Hallelujah. Not by might nor by power, but by the Spirit of the Almighty God, he's able to do that which is exceedingly great, powerful, wonderful, far above anything you ever dreamed or thought. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He has some good thoughts towards you. He has good thoughts. Say, he has good thoughts. What's your name? Brian. Come on. You have a record too?
Some people think so.
No, I'm not thinking so. I'm asking you a question.
No.
Not yet. And when I say not yet.
Not yet.
God's going to give you a record. Not criminal. But a wonderful record in him. Give me your arm. Hallelujah. Put those legs together. Come on, walk. Hallelujah. He's a wonderful, loving, life-giving God. You know, the Lord was just going to deliver you from smoking, too. Would that be all right? Won't that be all right?
That'd be all right. Somebody told me that today, actually.
Someone told you that today?
Yeah.
Well, that's wonderful. Hallelujah. How much is a pack of cigarettes now?
$7.
Well, the next time you want a pack of cigarettes, take the $7 and go give it to that lady right there. Victoria.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Sow it into the kingdom of God. And see the wonderful things. Hallelujah. God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for this young man in whom you have saved. You have washed him. You have cleansed him. You've gave him a brand new, wonderful way in the Lord. And now, Lord, he has a habit. And we're asking you, Lord, to deliver him from that habit in the name of Jesus Christ. We command the desire of nicotine to go away and not to come back again in the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask you to take him out of smoking and bring him into the kingdom, into your throne room of glory, and fill him afresh in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And Lord, all of those bad words that comes up in his mouth and those things, that take that out too. Just set him free. Hallelujah. Put words of life, words of joy, words of peace, words that bring hope to someone else in the mouth. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. And fill him with the Holy Ghost. Fill him with the power. Fill him with your love. Fill him with your strength in Jesus' wonderful and glorious name. Hallelujah. You know, God is cleaning you up so you can run through the nations for Him. Hallelujah. You can run like a trooper. Hallelujah. Now lift your hands and say, Jesus, you live in my heart, and I want the Holy Ghost. I want the Holy Ghost with power. I want the Holy Ghost fire. And I want it now. I need it now. I need it now. I need it now. Look to Jesus and say, I need it now. I need that. I need that overcoming power. Hallelujah. Working in my life. Hallelujah. Now, Lord, fill him with the Holy Spirit. And give him a brand new language to begin to speak with. That declares that you have filled him with your power. Hallelujah. Now take a deep breath in the Lord. Close your eyes and look at him. Just look at him. Everybody stretch your hands towards him. This is a vessel. A vessel that God's going to use mightily, powerfully. Hallelujah. Fill him with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Take a deep breath in the Lord. Take one more. And open your mouth and begin to speak. He's going to give you a new language. Oh, shatarababai, shatarababai. Speak it out. Shatarababai, speak it out. Shatarababai, shatarababai, speak it out. Koshatarababai, shatarababai.
Amen. Shamana kadamanashina.
Shatarababa, shatarababa. Oh, shatarababa. Keep on speaking. Shatarababa, keep on. Shakatarababa, shatarababa, shatarababa. Oh, shatarababa, keep on. Keep shatarababa, shatarababa. You're getting delivered, boy. Hallelujah. Shatarababa. Keep on speaking. Oh, Shatora, Shatora, Vaba, Shatora, Vai. Oh, Shatora, Vaba, Koto, Tora, Binka. Oh, Shababa, Baba, Shatora, Vaba. Oh, Shatora, Vaba, Shatora, Vaba. Oh, Shatora. Just pray with him. Oh, Shatora, Vaba. Hallelujah, boy, Shatora, Vaba. Don't stop. Shatora, Vaba, Shatora, Vaba. Oh, shatarababai, shatarababai. Sir, what's your name? Bernard Glass. Come. Hallelujah. Don't you stop. Reed, don't let him stop. Yeah, let it flow like a mighty river. Hallelujah. Do you have pain in your body?
I'm just getting over pain in my knee.
Is it painful tonight?
No, not tonight. Finally, it's been a week and it's easing up.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Thank you.
Amen. You know, God has a great call on your life. He has something wonderful for you to do for him. Amen?
Amen.
And all you have to do is just go do it. And as he touches you, he will touch you wonderfully and beautifully with his spirit and show you wonderful things in the Lord. And he'll fill your heart with faith. And you will arise and sing his song and take his glory out on the streets, out into the stores. People will see his glory upon your face. You love him, don't you?
Yes.
Lifting your hands unto him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The Lord saith unto thee, my son, you have gone a hard way much of the time, saith the Lord, but I've brought you out of the hard way, and I've brought you into the righteous way, saith the Lord. And I have filled you with life and hope and strength. And I shall give unto thee a new strength and a new power and a new glory, saith the Lord. And I shall show the wonder-working power of who I am within thy life. And you shall bring blessings and strength unto many people, saith the Lord. For I have brought you into my kingdom for such a time as this. So lift your hands, saith the Lord. Be filled with my glory. Be filled with my power. Be filled with my strength in a new and wonderful way. For this is a new day, saith the Lord. Now, are you speaking in other tongues every day?
Predominantly English.
Predominantly English. Well, how about that kingdom language?
That's very important.
Yeah, so you need to speak more in that language than English.
Yes.
So are you speaking in that language?
More.
More? Well, let's do that right now. So go ahead and start talking. No, you're just saying amen to me. Hallelujah. Everybody stretch your hands towards this wonderful vessel of the Lord. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be filled with His power. Be filled with His glory. Be filled. Hallelujah. Take a deep breath. Just breathe Him in. He wants to fill you with His power, fill you with His fire. Take one more deep breath. Shantara shadadava. Open your mouth and speak. You're going to speak in a new language. Oh, shadadadava ba, shadadava ba. Speak it out. Shantara shatoria shikatoria. You begin speaking and He's going to give you a language.
Good teacher.
Shantoria, to keep on teaching, speaking. Shantara vabotoria shatora shatora ba. Open your mouth and speak. Shantoria antoria rian sitana. No more English. Another wonderful heavenly language coming. Open your mouth and speak. Comes out of here. Oh, shatadadian siotorati. Hallelujah. Speak it out. Oh, santoradadadaba. Hallelujah. Batorashandoradadababai. No more hallelujah. Bashantoravai. Oh, Shatorababa Shantara. Come and just pray with Him. Speak in other tongues. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a great big hand clap. Hallelujah. If you're sick this morning, this afternoon, can you come real quickly? We're going to pray for you. Believe God for a miracle. Hallelujah. If you're not sick, keep on speaking, young man. Hallelujah. Wonderful Jesus. If you're not sick and you need a financial miracle, come and line up. Hallelujah. Wonderful Jesus. Wonderful. These are the sick folks up here. Hallelujah. Lifting your hands. Hallelujah. Now, who all is sick?